This episode is brought to you by Skillshare. When thinking about sustainable cities of the future, we envision a grid of roads and vertical farms and skyscrapers. But what if a different urban perspective was on the horizon? Saudi Arabia is planning to disrupt the vertical and grid-like trend with the line, the backbone of the Neom megalopoly. At a cost of $500 billion, they're touting this 100-mile-long linear city as the most sustainable urban complex in the world, and one with some cutting-edge renewable technologies, like generating fresh water in a desert. But will it work? Let's explore if Neom is a flight of fancy or the future of sustainable cities. I'm Matt Ferrell. Welcome to Undecided. Blending Greek and Arabic languages, Neom means new future. And it might be a very near future too, according to Mohammed bin Salman, the crown prince of Saudi Arabia. Back in 2017, the Saudi billionaire announced the line would be completed by 2025, but recent estimates predict it's most likely 2030. That's still an aggressive timeline for a megacity that will be 33 times larger than New York City. Now, this project is part of the Saudi Vision 2030 program, whose bottom line is to develop new avenues for the country's economy. So many possible puns with this one. So it's not a coincidence that the prince announced the Neom project in 2017, just a year before the oil price hit a new low, which was 63% lower than the peak in 2012. Saudi Arabia has been heavily reliant on its oil reserve, which is the second largest in the world. But they realized this could pose a risk for the country's future, so instead of oil, they bet on technologies, scientific research, and tourism. So what's special about Neom? Well, the project boasts the Saudi linear city as a revolution in urban living. Saudi Arabia will build the smart infrastructure in the northwestern Tabuk province, strategically originating at the junction between North Africa and the Arabian Peninsula. The line will be within a four-hour flight for over 40% of the global population. Now, besides Saudi Arabia, the line will cross Egypt and Jordan. In fact, the Neom project also includes a construction of a bridge across the Strait of Tehran, connecting Saudi Arabia with Egypt. Expected to host 1 million people, the Neom urban design will feature three levels. The top ground layer will be a fully pedestrian area with green parks and zero cars. Just underneath, they'll build a services area including shops and offices. At the very bottom, the spine will connect the city's modules along the line with AI-driven vehicles, metro, and ultra-high-speed trains. You're supposed to be able to buzz through the whole route within 20 minutes. The project has some crazy flights of fancy, from creating the illusion of a giant artificial moon using drones to cloud seeding to produce rain. But let's just set those aside and focus on the more meaningful approaches. One of the big goals of Neom's designers will create a renewable oasis. They claim clean energy will produce fresh water from the sea and power the whole infrastructure. Now that all sounds great, but there are some environmental and social impacts to consider. The line will cross Jabal al-Az, the Almond Mountain in Arabic. It's one of the most popular tourist sites in Saudi Arabia. The Neom website acknowledges that this area is a challenge for accessibility and will likely be the least populated zone of the whole infrastructure, but the line is already impacting people who live in the area. Saudi forces are trying to deport around 20,000 Al-Hawatat tribe members. I apologize if I mispronounce that name. After the suspicious death of a tribe activist in 2020, human rights organizations called for a UN investigation. On top of all that, is the Neom project even economically viable? Research conducted just after the Neom's official launch reveals some economic challenges. Despite the fancy website, the many advertising videos, and the intention of turning Neom into a free trade zone, some experts point out that the Saudi government will have a hard time attracting private investors. That's because of the lack of information about the city development, excessive bureaucracy, and unclear regulations. Despite the crown prince's enthusiasm and his over-the-top presentation, many scientists are skeptical about his dream coming true. Like Mark Laverne, the director of the National Center for Scientific Research, who believes a project like Neom isn't viable from an economical and technological point of view in such a short time. So does that mean Neom is just a public relations strategy or a real project? Well, we'll need to see how things progress down the line, but some of the technologies that Saudi Arabia is trying out could be a huge benefit for sustainability on a global scale. That's why it's worth taking a deeper dive into some of them. So first, let's look at the pros of some of these technologies. Now, one of the key assets of the line is their advanced transport system. Its underground trains are supposed to be operating at over 300 miles per hour, but are there trains reaching that speed at the moment? There are two options, maglev and Hyperloop trains. Last year, the Central Japan Railway Company introduced the L0 series improved superconducting magnetic levitation, or smaglev. You gotta love acronyms. With a max speed of 310 miles per hour, the smaglevs levitates at 4 inches above the rails. In fact, levitation overcomes the problem of friction between the wheels and the rails, which maximizes the velocity. But what makes it levitate and move forward? Well, these trains float thanks to a repulsion force between two sets of magnetized coils. The first set, with the North Pole facing up, runs along the maglev trackway or guideway, and the other one, with the North Pole facing down, is underneath the train's carriage. And once the train is up in the air, an electric current is passed through the propulsion magnets, which are set to alternate between North and South poles. By constantly changing the direction of the current, the magnets continuously switch their polarity. The resulting magnetic fields push both the front and the back of the train forward. Also, the voltage powering the magnets can be used to power the train's appliances. Unlike the original L0 series, the improved Smaglev is fully powered by a more innovative and eco-friendly inductive system. Now, this gets electricity wirelessly from the coils without relying on a gas turbine, which means no exhaust emissions. But there's another major advantage. Using liquid nitrogen and liquid helium, Japanese engineers cool the onboard Smaglev's electromagnets down to 452 degrees Fahrenheit below zero. At such low temperatures, the electrical resistance of their magnets, the raw materials, niobium and titanium, is basically zero. This makes these superconducting electromagnets generate electricity even after the power has been switched off, and produce magnetic fields that are up to 10 times stronger than normal electromagnets. Magnetic levitation is also one of the principles behind Hyperloop technology. I've done a deep dive on Hyperloop in another video, which I'll link to in the description, but to break it down quickly here, it's essentially a maglev train in a vacuum-sealed tube. The Hyperloop's low-pressure system gets rid of the air resistance, so moving in near-zero friction, pods could travel much faster than maglev using lower energy. Elon Musk proposed his Hyperloop concept back in 2012, and since then he's encouraged innovators to try to make it a reality. As of today, version Hyperloop 1 seems to be the one that's in the fast lane or track, with their pods designed to glide at near supersonic speed of 670 miles per hour. Now, Hyperloop portals would allow people to move swiftly from one urban center to another. Richard Branson's company signed a deal with KSA's transport ministry to assess how Hyperloop could fit the country's innovative infrastructure plans. Other than fast transportation, the Neom project will need a lot of fresh water to quench the thirst of its million residents, which is no small feat considering that Saudi Arabia will be one of the 9 most water-stressed countries in the world by 2040. So far, the country has relied on desalination plants, which remove salt from seawater using 2 basic processes. The first, and the oldest one, is thermal desalination. Basically, just heat up seawater and cool down the produced steam back into fresh water. The newer and more prevalent alternative is reverse osmosis. In this case, you apply high pressure to force seawater through a semi-permeable membrane which separates salts from water. Now, although less energy intensive than the thermal approach, reverse osmosis still requires high energy, which currently means a lot of fossil fuels being burned. Now, on global scale, desalination plants are responsible for about 76 million tons of CO2 equivalents per year. And if we don't decarbonize the desalination industry, the already salty carbon budget is supposed to rise to about 500 million tons of CO2 equivalents per year by 2040. Another major environmental impact of reverse osmosis is the discharge of the residual highly concentrated slurry, or the brine, back into the ocean. Being much denser than seawater, hypersaline brine sinks to the bottom. The increase in salt content triggers a drop in oxygen, which harms the marine ecosystem. The bad news is that the global number of reverse osmosis desalination plants has increased exponentially over the last 60 years. And guess who's in the lead? You guessed it, Saudi Arabia, with 15% of the global capacity. But the Neom developers are about to deliver a sweet deal for the KSA and possibly the entire world. They're partnering with the UK-based Solar Water to develop the first ever solar dome to produce clean water out of the Red Sea. The exposed part of the dome is a glass semisphere extending 25 meters upward. This covers an equal-sized metal underground semisphere, which is filled by seawater coming through a glass aqueduct. The dome's advanced thermal desalination method taps into concentrating solar power, or CSP. Basically, it's a large number of parabolic mirrors which will focus solar radiation onto the glass dome. The localized greenhouse effect will heat up the lower metallic kind of kettle containing the seawater, and the resulting steam will be pumped out through pipelines. After condensation, the fresh water will feed reservoirs and irrigation channels. And unlike the conventional reverse osmosis process, solar water said the waste brine collected at the bottom of the dome will be reused for different applications like lithium batteries, grit for roads, fertilizers, or detergents. According to their CEO, this 100% carbon neutral desalination plant is the future solution for accessing environmentally safe and sustainable fresh water. The leader of Neom's water sector said the dome will be able to generate 500,000 cubic meters of clean water per day and produce energy out of wastewater to close out the loop. But what about the cost? While recent studies said solar and energy storage technologies could drag down the global average levelized cost of desalinated water to around $1.20 per cubic meter by 2050, and the solar dome designers aim to water that down further to about 34 cents per cubic meter, which is obviously unsalted peanuts compared to the fossil fuel desalination plants. The first solar dome is currently being built and scheduled to be completed by the end of this year, and it's going to serve as a testbed for industrial applications worldwide, and something to absolutely keep an eye on. But what's going to power all of Neom's other fancy technologies? Through a $5 billion partnership, Air Products and Saudi-based ACWA Power will build the world's largest green hydrogen and green ammonia facility, an innovative 4-gigawatt hybrid system combining solar and wind power, plus energy storage to power the city and export surplus of clean energy worldwide. Using ThyssenKrupp electrolyzers, the plant will produce 650 tons of hydrogen per day. ThyssenKrupp engineers will build a 20-megawatt modular alkaline electrochemical cell, which is, wow, that's a mouthful to say, to break down water into hydrogen and oxygen. The use of alkaline aqueous solutions as electrolytes will boost the electricity transmission, which means the hydrogen production will be more efficient, up to 82% for the ThyssenKrupp unit. Also, powering electrolysis with renewables rather than fossil fuels will reduce the process's carbon emissions by about 55%. The 650 tons a day of hydrogen that they produce will feed the Haldor topsail rig, where it will be reacted with nitrogen and converted into 3,500 tons of green ammonia per day. It's a lot of steps, but after cooling it down, the liquid green energy-rich ammonia will be safer and easier to carry around. It's the easiest and safest way to transport hydrogen. At its final destination, the eco-friendly ammonia can be cracked back into hydrogen and nitrogen. The plan is to use hydrogen to fuel buses and trucks. And with a high level of insulation levels and average wind speeds of around 10 meters per second, the Neom location is well suited to combine solar and wind power. Air Products CEO said the green energy plant will save over 3 million tons of CO2 per year, and this is all expected to be operational in 2025. At least that's what Neom's advocates are saying, which brings me to the potential downsides of all of this. The Neom's technologies sound very promising, but are they going to be ready and functional by 2030? Before I get to that, I'd like to thank Skillshare for sponsoring this video. They've built an incredible online learning community with thousands of classes for creators, and when it comes down to it, we're all creators. They've got classes for everything from writing, to graphic design, to web development, to entrepreneurship and leadership. Most recently, I've been on a productivity kick, working smarter, not harder, and they've got some amazing productivity classes as well. I've been running through Thomas Frank's Productivity for Creatives class, and it's been extremely helpful. He's run through how to set up my physical and digital space to remove friction and get out of my way, how to get into the creative mindset and stay there. Everything from Skillshare is curated for learning, so there's no ads, and they're always launching new premium classes. There's really something for everyone on Skillshare to continue learning and growing. There's nothing better than being able to do something today that you couldn't do yesterday. The first 1,000 people to use the link in the description will get a 1-month free trial of Skillshare. Thanks to Skillshare and to all of you for supporting the channel. So can all of this be ready and functional by 2030? Well, as for the near supersonic trains, the short answer is very unlikely. One of the Japanese maglev trains hit a world record speed of 374 miles per hour back in 2016, yet it was only a test run. The $84 billion first commercial scale track between Tokyo and Osaka won't be completed until 2027, and that timeline might be extended because local authorities are worried about potential environmental impacts and are delaying the tunnel digging along the route. And then there's the Hyperloop. Despite being much faster than maglev in theory, in practice, Hyperloop is lagging behind. Virgin Hyperloop proved its prototype scale pods at their Nevada test track, but it was only this past November that the first passengers rode the test track. It was the world's first experiment ever for this technology and was also short and relatively slow. Only 550 yards at around 100 miles per hour. Branson's team is hoping to reach commercial scale by 2030, but it's still not clear if they'll meet that deadline. What about the solar dome? Does it hold fresh water? The application of concentrated solar power technology for thermal desalination has never been demonstrated on a commercial scale yet. To add to that, solar water is quoting a very competitive price. This obviously raises some doubts on the long-term reliability and the economic feasibility of Neom's solar dome. Leon Auerbach, an expert in the desalination industry, he pointed out the lack of information on energy recovery and other technical data released by the dome designers. Auerbach also labeled the 34 cents per square meter price tag as extremely ambitious. So ambitious that someone suspects it might only include operating cost, but not the initial capital costs for the solar mirrors, which can be a big difference. researchers found that concentrated solar power-based thermal desalination projects could lead to much higher levelized cost of water than what's being touted by solar power, based on a price range of 94 cents per cubic meter to $4.31 per cubic meter. The authors concluded that the viability of the solar dome is hard to achieve. As for waste brine, solar water's reuse plans have not been clearly defined. Also, there might be some limitations to the proposed brine applications. For instance, if it's used as fertilizer, the byproduct shouldn't contain any heavy metals or other toxic chemicals. Now, this isn't to say that it's not possible or it's not going to happen, but that there's a lot of open questions to be proven out over the next few years. Now, from the energy point of view, Neom's plans sound electrifying. Yet the green project has some red flags. For instance, ammonia generation will still rely on dirty, energy-intensive processes like the Haber-Bosch reaction. Despite the presence of an ion catalyst, you need a temperature of up to 450 degrees Celsius and pressures of 200 atmospheres to break down the nitrogen molecule. Also, will a 4 gigawatt capacity be enough to satisfy the line's energy demands? According to Neom's head of energy, it probably won't. In the worst case scenario, the Saudis will have to build around 7 more of these plants in the next 10 years. Which sounds like a lot. But the major challenge for the future will be to find cheaper energy storage solutions. Based on a recent study, although wind and solar power systems implemented by Neom's project will cost less than 3 cents per kilowatt hour, they'll have to be integrated with lithium-ion batteries at an extra cost of about 28 cents per kilowatt hour. There are other storage technologies to choose from, but it's a cost that still has to be considered. The Saudi Arabian project is clearly ambitious, maybe overly ambitious, but it seems to be in line with a sustainable urban future. There's still clouds hanging over the Arab oasis, like tight timelines for technology development and a lack of disclosure on economical and technical details. But whether or not the city comes to fruition as it was originally proposed really doesn't matter. If they're able to prove out some of these technologies at a large scale, it could benefit the global community. The solar dome alone could end up being one of the most impactful for the broader world. But what do you think about Neom? Is the line just a prince's fantasy, or do you think that there could be broader impact from some of these technologies? Jump in the comments and let me know. If you like this video, be sure to check out one of the ones I've linked to right here. Be sure to subscribe and hit that notification bell if you think I've earned it. And as always, thanks to all my patrons and a big welcome to new producer Shell Carney. Your support really helps to make these videos possible. And thanks to all of you for watching. I'll see you in the next one.